thank you, everybody, for joining us for today's webcast. We're going to talk about bringing advanced analytics to the business. So my name is Amanda Tesco. I'm a BI and analytics consultant with Thorogood. I've been working for Thorogood for about 13 years now on enterprise BI and analytics strategies and implementations. And I am joining today's webcast from my home in Philadelphia. Now, for those of you who don't know Thorogood, we are an independent global professional services firm that specializes in business intelligence and analytics strategies, solutions, and services. We really focus on multi-skilled teams across data science, data engineering, and data visualization. We're a global company with offices in London, New York, Philadelphia, Singapore, Sao Paulo, and Bangalore, and we offer a full range of BI and analytics services, including strategies and roadmaps, as well as full implementations from requirements through to implementation and training and support. We work with a number of blue chip customers drawing from a range of sectors. The sectors that we most commonly work with are consumer goods, pharmaceutical, financial services, and insurance. And we are an independent consultancy and that we work with a range of technology partners. And our consultants are knowledgeable and experienced in a wide breadth of these technologies and the way those technologies can be integrated successfully in enterprise applications. I've listed some of our partnerships here. And today we won't focus on any one particular technology, but if you do have any questions about how some of the topics I'm talking about today might relate to these technologies, feel free to reach out and we can have some more specific discussions about that. So in today's session, we're going to talk about common challenges in getting the business to adopt advanced analytical techniques and really consider approaches for mitigating some of those challenges. Over the past decade, companies have become more attuned to the value that machine learning can bring their organizations. And what you'll see on the screen here is a study that MIT Sloan and BCG did recently that found that 71% of respondents felt they understood how AI would change the way their business generates value, but only 11% of those organizations were actually able to report significant financial benefits in 2020. And so what we're going to think about today is, why are some companies struggling to get the full benefit of their ML investments? And what is some advice that we can give based on some of the conversations and work we've done with our customers to avoid some of those challenges? I've structured the session today around four key recommendations, and I'll take you through each one of those individually and just give a little bit of a lens on why we think these are important things to consider when trying to figure out how to get their organization to really adopt analytics. I'm going to start with sharing the context widely. And so what do we mean by that? Well, it's really important that we help all members of an organization understand why we're investing in AI and in ML. And it's important that we understand the context about why we're talking about it right now. Is it just buzz, or has something fundamentally happened that's pushing organizations to invest heavily? So let's talk a little bit about what's going on in the world today. Several developments have really enabled the conditions for machine learning to thrive at new levels. So technological advances, think about our smartphones, the Internet of Things, and changing consumer behavior have really resulted in a proliferation of data. Advances in cloud computing have made storing and processing that data cheaper and easier than ever before. And the availability of open source libraries, particularly for statistical packages, and the evolution of analytics tools tool capabilities have really made it possible to apply statistical techniques in new ways and at a scale that was previously impossible or at least inaccessible for many businesses. As these conditions have acted as enablers, what we're seeing is many organizations investing heavily in experimenting with machine learning and AI to see if they can find value that was previously pretty hard to uncover. Why would a company want to do this? Is it about disrupting? Is it about avoiding disruption? Is it to get a competitive advantage? Is it avoiding risk? One thing that we know is that everybody else is doing it. So, you know, is that good enough? But thinking about the context for why your organization is doing it is really important. The IDC spending guide that recently came out projects AI spend to reach $110 billion by 2024. And a Gartner survey that recently came out showed that despite a global pandemic, when many of our organizations are thinking about how do we cut back spending, 66 of organizations avoided cutting spending in AI, and many actually increased their investment. Now, in order to get your organization to successfully embrace analytics, I think it's first important that people recognize that the conditions have changed. This isn't just a buzzword. This isn't just, you know, on the agendas of the C-suite or managers in the company to do more AI and ML. It is something that has fundamentally changed the world and the nature of business. And many organizations have been investing heavily in it. But many companies who are concerned that they might be behind the curve can take a look at that Sloan and BCG study that we showed and see that though people are recognizing where the value exists, they've not yet gotten to a point that they can fully see the benefit. And so for many companies, that should be a good incentive to think about how can we kind of stay with the competition or even move ahead of the competition in this area. Once you start to warm people up to the case for analytics, how do you actually warm them up to using it to let it influence their decision making? And this is really a problem that we've talked about with many customers. Even when you're creating models that have value, how do you get people comfortable adopting this culture that is quite different from the culture that existed previously? Something that we think is really helpful in doing this is to really think about analytics as a spectrum. And so what do I mean by that? If you think about on the left-hand side, the simplest form of data that exists in your organization, think about a transactional record, a record that shows somebody scanned a UPC code or somebody submitted a policy to be quoted or a trade was made. That transactional data is very tangible to people. It's very transparent. It's easy for business users to understand, and it's foundational. It's core to being able to do any sort of analytics. And over time, companies have moved from just looking at transactional information to thinking more about some basic aggregations. So when you start to put sums, counts, mins, and maxes on that information, it gets richer. It starts to illuminate more things. But it's still pretty easy to understand. I know, you know, what a summation of sales by a certain country means. As we start to move further along the continuum, things start to get a little bit more opaque or a bit harder to interpret. So we can start bringing in descriptive statistics or statistical inference. We can bring those concepts into the data and applications that we use today by looking at things like means or the how many standard deviations away from a mean. We could look at the spread of the information or the distribution that sits behind some of the information that we're seeing. And as we start to apply statistics to it, we start to get a richer understanding of what might be happening with that data, but it starts to get a little bit more difficult for business users to really understand what exactly that means. And then when we move further towards the right, that's where we start to look at what we're calling analytical models. And analytical modeling is really just anytime you think you can use a model that will allow you to predict or understand something that's happening in the world. And with any model, there's error and there's ambiguity. And even within those models, there is a continuum of ones that might be simpler to understand. So for example, I would often encourage people who are just getting started with analytics, if you've been doing a bit of statistics and you want to start doing more analytical modeling, regression can solve a lot of problems and is fairly easy for people to understand. So it's not a bad place to start if you want to get the business on board with it. Many people fundamentally understand what the equation of a line looks like and the way coefficients might affect the shape of that line. So it's an easy way to start warming people up to it. Classification similarly has business rules that effectively get defined in a way that the business users can still understand what the model is bringing out and how it's being applied. But as we move further to the right, as we start doing things like clustering, where it's a little bit harder to understand exactly how those clusters get created, or optimization, where we're running a number of different things in the background to see what the optimal scenario is, or furthest to the right, when we start thinking about things like artificial neural networks, which are meant to kind of mimic the brain activity that happens, we start to find that those models might provide more illumination into the business. They might tell you things you've never known or would never find on your own, but they tend to be a little bit more opaque in understanding what it means, in trusting it, and knowing how to interpret it. And so we think that there's value across the spectrum in analytics. And when you're starting to think about how you build trust with a business, it's important to make sure that you're thinking about techniques that are as complex as they need to be, but no more complicated. So if you can find a lot of value in adding descriptive statistics to your reporting, you might not need to go all the way to the right side of the spectrum to warm people up to it. So a lot of it is about thinking about this trade-off between transparency and opaqueness, between easily interpretability and something that's a little bit harder to interpret, but the kind of more basic value versus more illuminating value. The other point I would make on this slide is that many people often think about data engineering, data science, and data visualization a bit separate. But really, the underpinnings of data science require really good and trusted data engineering and the real smart application of data visualization throughout to help aid the adoption of these things. So when you are thinking about the analytics continuum and building confidence in the data science solution, you've also got to be thinking about the smart application of data science, data visualization and data engineering, else you risk diminishing some of the trust that the business might have in these models that you're creating. We're going to talk a little bit next about the notion of experimentation. And I mentioned that these analytical models are where you're trying to fit a model to information so that you can use it to learn more about the world or to predict what's happening. And anytime you have this sort of experimentation where you see, is there a model that gives me the information I want? There are some other considerations that come along with it. And that is really one of the biggest struggles that we've seen companies deal with. So as you start to get the business used to experimenting, to applying analytical models to find if there is value there, the next thing is to really make sure that you know what happens after that experimentation. What we found is that recognizing the value that ML can provide, many companies have started by investing heavily in that experimentation. And I think that's why on that MIT Sloan study, you see 71% feel like they know how to apply AI and ML to get value in their business. But what we've seen is that many have struggled to move from that experimentation mindset to something that is much more operationalized. So something that actually gets used for decision making, that works at scale, that is trusted by others in the organization, and that's monitored and maintained in a way that you know the model you're using is gonna deliver value consistently and not start to drift or cause people to make decisions in a manner that would be irresponsible or in some cases even unethical. The practice of doing this, the practice of trying to make your ML more operationalized has a name, and that is MLOps. MLOps is a compound coming from machine learning and operations. And I would say that at the moment, this is the area where most of our customers are coming needing a lot of help to think about how they take the ML models that have been created traditionally by data scientists in very specialized areas and start to bring them into the enterprise fold by making sure that they are robust, repeatable, scalable, governed appropriately, monitored appropriately. The benefits of MLOps are many, and I won't go through all of them in this session today, but I have listed some of the components of MLOps here that provide a lot of value to the business. I would say the biggest takeaway in this webcast today is probably to recognize that if you've started down the journey of creating these ML models, it's really, really critical that you know what happens with those models once value is found to make sure that it actually gets actualized. To try to increase that 11% of companies who are seeing value, I think that MLOps is really a big part to being able to do it. And we are in the process of running an MLOps campaign right now that spans all sorts of different webcasts and white papers. So definitely feel free to go onto our website and take a look at that. You'll find a lot of information on there and a lot more information is coming up. And I'll share some of the links to that at the end of the presentation today. The last element that I really wanted to talk today about is the need to design strong, well-rounded teams. This and MLOps are two things that we've been talking to customers a lot about right now, which is what sort of people do I need to be able to do analytics successfully and to get it adopted in the organization? So many of you will probably have seen a slide like this or similar to this, where we recognize that doing these things requires bringing together strong business understanding, domain expertise with data science skills. So the ability to build those analytical models to understand the statistical concepts, and data engineers, those who are able to operationalize enterprise data to be able to make those analytic models used and monitored and supported in the correct way. And so many people have some version of this in their organization where they recognize a need across these things. Where a lot of our customers have been coming to us recently is to say, well, what about the overlap? So can these people exist as individuals, or do I need multi-skilled teams? And though many of our organizations have data scientists, data engineers, and really good business stakeholders, I think the area where organizations are lacking or thinking about how they supplement or build skills is in some of these overlap areas. And then the one that's sort of most confounding to people is, what about this center overlap? Is it even possible to go out on the market and to find somebody who can do all of these things? Or is it possible to build these skills within my organization? And do I need to? Something that we've been talking to customers about is really thinking about the specific need and trying to determine how much overlap is necessary within these teams. So I think that, you know, there are a number of use cases, just doing standard reporting where you start to bring more statistics into it. Even some early stage data science experimentation, where you can have a team that has those three skill sets in individual people and that just work really closely together. Just keep in mind that in those scenarios, you'll need really, really strong communication and collaboration channels. And you'll need people who are just kind of very open-minded to working outside of the domain that they might have the most experience in. But there are a lot of scenarios that can be satisfied that way. I think it is important to recognize, though, where there are scenarios where overlapped skills or where multi-skilled teams are necessary. And a couple that I think I've just called out a couple examples here, but one that we've talked about a little bit earlier is MLOps. And that's a place where we're finding understanding where the data science ends and where the data engineering begins when you go to operationalize a solution like that is pretty tricky. And so in those scenarios, it's really helpful to have some members of the team that have overlapping skills in data science and data engineering. You might still supplement that team with individual data scientists and individual data engineers. You might want to have some domain expertise overlapping in that. But there are some scenarios where those two circles you might find really require somebody that's multi-skilled. And then you might find there are some really transformational analytics applications that you're looking to do that really do necessitate having a lot of overlap, where you might need to think about how you build enough skills in your team to be able to do all of these things, where you might do rotational programs so that you get data scientists experience with data engineering or vice versa, where you might start training your business domain experts in some more data science or statistical techniques. And so it's important to just think, you know, not to assume that one model will work in every scenario, but to think about for the particular need, what does the overlap in skills need to look like for that team? And then as we talk to people about that, the next consideration is really, okay, if I've recognized that I need some multi-skilled members in my group, how do I get them? Because we're all kind of aware that, you know, there's not a huge market at the moment, or there are not many people in the market at the moment who necessarily embody all of these skills. And so we've been talking to a lot of customers about kind of three approaches to doing this. The first way you could get those skills is to build them yourself. So you might take existing team members who have some data science or some data engineering, and you build the knowledge in them that they need in other domains. The benefit of this is that you have existing relationships with these people and they have existing knowledge of the company. It also might tend to be less expensive. You've already got them. You don't have to go out and acquire new people or hire help. But the challenges here are that they've got to be really good learners. And, you know, I'll be pretty candid in saying not every data engineer wants to or can be a data scientist, and vice versa. Not every data scientist wants to get, you know, elbows deep in data engineering. So it might not be possible. It might also be difficult given the company's experience to be able to build those skills across people. So if the company itself doesn't have the data science skills, teaching your data engineers to have really good data science skills might be challenging. It can also be pretty time intensive and not that flexible, because if every time you've got to do this, every time there are new skills that need to be learned, you've got to retrain people, it takes a while to be able to respond. Does that delay how quickly you can respond to the analytic needs of the organization? Another approach is to consider borrowing these skills, and that's where you might use consultants, specialists, or contractors for certain skills. Some of the pros of this is that it's pretty flexible as your needs change. So because they're not kind of on the books, you know, for a full year, you're not paying benefits, you get to kind of work out where you need those skills, the breadth that you need, the depth that you need, and it tends to be the quickest to implement. So if you're looking to kind of go out and find a good partner for this, it's usually a good way to get moving and to kind of jumpstart some of your analytics programs. The cons is that, you know, you obviously don't own the talent. And so you'll be giving people expertise in your organization and experience there. But at the end of the day, that they aren't yours, you can't entirely control them. It does, you know, create a bit of a dependence on a third party. And they might have, you know, more limited company specific experience. You might also find you're paying, you know, a premium rate for skills that are really hard or difficult to build. So I think it makes sense to think about where borrowing might be part of your strategy for certain scenarios, for certain high value activities, perhaps in those overlapping fields that are difficult to build. But I think it's nice to think it as part of the solution that you can use in thinking about how you gain these skills. And then the last one is really buying. So can you just go out and hire the talent with the desired skills and experience that you need? And if you can do that, it's valuable because you own that high caliber talent, at least to some extent. It can be used to skill up other people. So you can then make use of those members to maybe do a bit of the build strategy as well. And you can go out and try to hire the exact skill sets you need. Some of the cons with this, many of you will know, it's very difficult to find people out on the market that you can hire that have the combination of all the skills you need. You do risk attrition because those people are in high demand. You do always risk that another company will come along and poach them from you, that you'll be probably paying premium salaries, higher cost of employment for them. And they might have limited company specific experience. So as opposed to a build strategy where you're working with people who already know the company, you're now having to kind of also train people in the company and its ways of working. It could also be a bit of a rigid solution. So if you go out and you pay top dollar for somebody who has these technical skills and these data science skills, and then as technology evolves in 6 months, you find you actually need something different. You bring in a new tool, you have a new business case that they're not familiar with. It's not that flexible to just go out and hire somebody every single time. And so, you know, in looking at these three strategies, I think the point isn't that there is one correct one. I think it's that for each use case, our customers should think about what is the blend of these approaches that you can use to make sure you have the skills that you need. And oftentimes it'll be a little bit of each. You'll definitely want to invest in building skills in your organization. It would be silly not to, but that might take too long. So you might want to think about borrowing skills that might also help build some skills. And, you know, we've seen many of our customers go out and try to hire on the market to see, can they find somebody that has exactly what they want? So I think it's more about being conscious of the different options here and thinking about the ways that you can leverage the pros of each of these to do something that is most effective for what has to happen within your organization to really build that culture around analytics. So with that, I'll just recap a couple of things and then I'll share some information on some upcoming events and some more information on MLOps for you. Today we looked a little bit at that analytics continuum and thinking about how do you start small with getting the business to warm up to this idea of statistics, simpler analytic models, so that you can get that balance and the trade-off right between transparency and opaqueness and more illuminating answers with something that might be a bit more straightforward. We talked about really shifting thinking to embrace operationalization. So not just letting your data science budgets go into experimenting and finding that models just end up sitting on somebody's local machine somewhere and never really get used, never really bring value to the business. Thinking about MLOps and the value that it provides, I think is really, really critical to delivering actual tangible benefit from your investments. We talked a little bit about designing strong, well-rounded teams and the need for business data science and data engineering, and also the fact that you will need multi-skilled players in some of those teams and for some scenarios, and that it makes a lot of sense to work out for each use case, how multi-skilled does the team need to be? Can I have three individuals just working together closely, or do I need overlap in skills in certain individuals? And as you start to think about building skills, we talked about getting the skills right by thinking about using a build, borrow, or buy methodology, applying whichever one makes the most sense in which scenario, and probably doing a bit of all of these things to make sure that you're responding to the speed that you need to respond at, but also thinking about the long-term sustainability of creating an analytics culture within your organization. So with that, I'll leave you with my contact information. Again, you know, feel free to reach out if you have any questions, or if you want to chat, feel free to link in with me. Always happy to talk to you guys more about any of these topics or anything in particular that you might be interested in on BI and analytics. Thank you guys so much, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your day.